Normally, we talk a lot about Tesla, but our channel is all about disruptive technologies. So in today's episode, let's focus on some other highly interesting technology developments. For example, the Las Vegas Boring Tunnel has now reached an important milestone and is right on track to open for CES 2021. Then, the first air taxi trial service is starting outside of China in New Zealand. On that occasion, we'd also like to take the time to debunk some misconceptions about flying air taxis.
And another extremely disruptive mode of transportation is, of course, the Hyperloop. A bill has been passed in Missouri that could enable a Hyperloop to be constructed between St. Louis and Kansas City. But much more is happening in the field of Hyperloop. Now here we would also like to debunk most of the naysayer arguments against Hyperloop. So stay tuned for these highly interesting technology developments.
So let's start with the Boring Company, one of the potentially disruptive ventures from Elon Musk. Last week, the Las Vegas Boring Tunnel reached an important milestone, namely the completing of digging work for the first tunnel. The almost 1 mile long tunnel is now completely dug out, which connects the two ends of the Las Vegas Convention Center. It will reduce travel time from currently 15 minutes down to 1 minute. Now the second tunnel, because we of course want to commute in both directions, will start to be dug out. The tunnel system is therefore right on track to open for CES 2021. And it will not only allow Tesla cars to travel through the tunnel, but it will also have passenger pods, which will allow for up to 16 people per pod in seated and standing position. They will use a modified Tesla chassis and might look similar to this animation here. But we haven't been shown a working prototype yet. We hope these passenger pods will be revealed soon. After CES 2021, the Las Vegas tunnel system will be gradually expanded until at some point in the 2020s, a Boring Company tunnel system called Loop will connect the convention center to the strip and eventually also to the airport. Other projects that are now being considered for the Boring Company are a loop for Los Angeles, a loop for Chicago, and one for connecting Washington DC and Baltimore. So let's see how the Boring Loop system will develop. Our mantra always is, the more modes of transportation we have, the better. Another choice we will soon have are flying air taxis. They will happen, ladies and gentlemen, they will. Whether you like it or not. In this video here, we were talking about the first trial run of flying taxis in Guangzhou, China, the first city worldwide to host a commercial flying taxi service. Now it's happening also outside of China, with the second country being, wait for it, New Zealand. So interesting, who would have thought? Yes. The city of Canterbury will apparently become the first city outside of China to have a trial run of flying air taxis. And the air taxis in question will be provided by Wisk, with their vehicle named Cora. It's a partnership between Kitty Hawk and Boeing. Now we know that Boeing likes to have some issues lately, but we are sure that Kitty Hawk, having been founded by ex-Google people, will know how to avoid another disaster. A memorandum of understanding has been signed between the New Zealand government and Wisk, and the trials are set to start soon. Cora has a range of 40 kilometers and flies at a speed of up to 160 kph. It's electric, fully autonomous, and will be called via app, similar to a ride-sharing service. It will land in a safe designated area and then fly you fully autonomously to your destination.
Now we'd like to take the time to address some arguments people often like to bring forth against flying air taxis. We are often kind of surprised how negative people actually are against flying air taxis, even open-minded and very intelligent people who normally totally get disruptive technologies, especially regarding SpaceX and Tesla, we are amazed to find that even they are actually quite negative on flying air taxis. Now, this really surprises us, since autonomous electric air taxis are a totally normal evolutionary step as another mode of transportation. Now, let's take a look at some of the most used arguments. They are extremely loud. Ah, my ears! Well, okay, many of these prototypes indeed still are loud. However, even they are not nearly as loud as a helicopter anymore. First of all, they are all electric, so no combustion noise. Then, the rotor design is such as to reduce vibrations of the rotor blades considerably. For example, the German startup ESAT has developed an ultra-low noise architecture for a VTOL flying air taxi, which is currently under development and is set to have the first maiden flight in 2 years. And when finished, it will be no louder than a current-day diesel or gasoline car driving past you in the city. So no, a helicopter is not a flying air taxi. Those things are extremely loud and, compared to new air taxi designs, extremely unsafe. But more on safety later. And then many say, but hey, air taxis are inefficient because they need to work against gravity. Oh, okay, but then you also shouldn't take an airplane next time you want to travel further away, because last we heard, airplanes also need to work against gravity. And many, many people use airplanes. Or rockets for that matter. We all love Starship, don't we? We all love rockets. They have to work a lot against the gravity well of Earth. Now, improvements in aerodynamic shape and battery energy density will actually enable VTOL air taxis not to only be very silent, but also to sport a range of hundreds of kilometers with speeds of hundreds of kilometers per hour. Just imagine an air taxi service in a vertical urban environment such as Manhattan. This will severely reduce travel time to anywhere in the city, and they will easily be able to land on specially adapted rooftops. They fly over our heads and they will crash and fall onto people on the streets, and it will be a disaster. Now, of course, first of all, they will only fly in special corridors. And on top, the next generation of air taxis will have quite some redundant safety systems, such as many independently working systems and rotors. Even parachutes are under consideration in case of emergency, which you can't do with a helicopter. The Cora air taxi will have, for example, an emergency parachute, which will be deployed in the very, very unlikely case that all rotors and all board computers should cease functioning at the same time. Then the parachute will deploy and the Cora air taxi will gently glide down onto the street level. And we haven't heard of a helicopter yet which can do that. For example, my favorite guitar player Stevie Ray Vaughan died in a helicopter crash, and the parachute would have been a good thing, okay? So electric VTOL air taxis really have quite some advantages as compared to our current day helicopters.
Oh yeah, and they are electric, meaning they won't stink or pollute. So there are quite a few arguments for flying air taxis. They will happen, ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not. Another thing that will happen whether you like it or not is Hyperloop. Now sure, the progress is slow, which of course encourages many naysayers. Naysayers always come out when something is difficult and takes time. Bam! They are here, waiting to spill out negativity. So let us explain why we think it's crystal clear that Hyperloop will happen. It's as clear as that Tesla will become the biggest car maker by 2030, and as clear as SpaceX being the first company to establish a moon and a Mars colony. So first, let's take a look at a very encouraging development. The state of Missouri has now passed a bill which will allow Virgin Hyperloop 1 to move forward with their proposed Hyperloop track connecting Kansas City, which finally is not in Kansas, and St. Louis. Let's hope the Hyperloop station in St. Louis won't be in this neighborhood here. We heard that there are some dangerous hoods in St. Louis. Anyways, the bill passed the State House of Representatives, and a 15-mile test track is to be built before work on a full connection between these two cities can start. According to a study for this project, the Missouri Hyperloop could create as many as 17,200 jobs, and spurred close to $3.7 billion in annual economic activity. Then we of course have the Great Lakes Hyperloop system, where a feasibility study has been only conducted 3 months ago and came to the conclusion that operational costs wouldn't require any subsidies. The travel time would be reduced from hours to minutes. Over 900,000 jobs would be created over 25 years, and tens of billions of dollars in economic benefit would be created throughout the region. Oh yeah, and a decrease in carbon emissions by 143 million tons. Other worldwide projects are the Dubai Abu Dhabi Hyperloop, the Mumbai Pune Hyperloop, and so on and so forth. Many new Hyperloop startups are entering the scene. Transport, a Canadian company, announced their plan of building a 1.86 mile test track in France. Zelaris Hyperloop, a Spanish company, aims to become one of the main European players developing this disruptive system. Hyper Poland, a Polish company, is working on bringing Hyperloop technologies to existing railways and corridors in their country. And finally, Hart Hyperloop, a Dutch company.
So there is indeed a lot happening in this field. But then of course the naysayers come and they say, but I cannot see Hyperloop anywhere and the progress with Hyperloop is so slow, so it's all a scam. It's a scam. Well, we want to kindly remind the naysayers how long it actually took, for example, the automobile, yes, the automobile which we just take for granted nowadays, to get a foothold in the United States. Now let's take a look at this nice chart here showing the market growth of automobiles in the US since 1900. What can we see here? Our famous logistics S-curve, which describes how disruptive technologies are growing. Remember, the automobile was already invented quite some time earlier in 1885 by Carl Benz in Germany. Yes, Germans also used to invent things a long time ago, not only you Americans. That was a long time ago, unfortunately not anymore. So a naysayer in 1905, and we are sure there were many of them, would have said, no one will use the automobile, it's a scam, it will never be adopted. Even in 1910, a whopping 25 years after the invention of the automobile, there were hardly any automobiles in the US, as we can see on this chart. Only in the 1920s did it really start taking off, 35 years after the invention. So it really takes quite some time until a new disruptive technology starts taking off and entering the exponential growth phase. And this is where many people fail to understand how technology grows. It grows exponentially. The exponential curve is really, really slow in the beginning, so slow that you don't notice it, and then suddenly, bam! This is exactly how disruption works. That's why so many people get disrupted. The CEOs of Nokia and BlackBerry weren't stupid, but they were taken completely by surprise. And now the legacy car makers, the exact same thing. They are not stupid, but they underestimate the power of the exponential growth curve. And so back to our car example, by the 1930s, horses were already almost completely gone from the streets and being completely replaced by the automobile in the matter of a very, very short time. But only 15 years earlier, there were no automobiles on the street. And this is extremely similar to what is happening right now with the Hyperloop. Remember that it was only proposed in 2013 by Elon in his famous white paper. We are only 7 years down the road. 7 years! We are basically now in 1892 if we compare to the automobile. So of course the naysayers are still feeling confirmed. But with all these new startups, with all these test tracks, with all these Hyperloop projects being under consideration all over the world, it's absolutely clear that it's only a matter of time until we will enter the exponential phase. We think this will happen in the early 2030s. And by the way, we think that the US will completely bypass a bullet train rail system and go directly for Hyperloop. Now call us completely crazy, but we think that by 2050, Hyperloop travel across the US will be completely standard. And don't forget, the Hyperloop will actually be quite a lot safer than regular railroads. A part will not be able to derail. A person cannot fall or be pushed in front of a Hyperloop track, contrary to trains where this stuff unfortunately happens every single day. But then you might say terrorists can easily destroy the Hyperloop, right? Yeah, but they can also destroy railroad tracks, can't they? And we already have bullet trains traveling with very high speeds all around the world.
So now to the best naysayer argument. It's impossible to maintain a vacuum inside a tube. Wrong. It's not a perfect vacuum. It's low pressure air at about 10% atmospheric pressure. Therefore, it takes much, much less energy to maintain than for a vacuum. Then another argument. Where should this huge amount of energy needed come from? Well, the beauty of it is that the Hyperloop will be fully self-powered. The tubes will be outfitted with solar cells. Therefore, the Hyperloop will entirely generate its own electricity needed to transport the pods. Then the best argument. The speed is so high, it's extremely unsafe. Really? You also did fly with an airplane at a speed of 600 miles per hour or not? The Hyperloop pods will be extremely far away from each other so that they cannot collide. There will be two separate tubes for the two opposing directions, never ever to cross. Contrary to some railroads, where accidents like these happen quite often. In case of emergency, the whole system can be shut down quite easily. The pods coming to a standstill. Exit portholes can be arranged every 100 meters for evacuation. And so on and so forth. Naysayers often don't like change. They don't like new stuff. There were naysayers against the automobile. There were naysayers against the airplane. There were also naysayers against the railroad. It all happened. Therefore, Hyperloop will also happen.
A new Kondratiev supercycle is starting right now, ladies and gentlemen. Right now. The last one was, of course, computers, telecommunications, and the internet. The next one will be gigantic. It will be as transformative as the one who spurred the Industrial Revolution in the 1800s. It really will be a new Industrial Revolution on so many different technology levels. And we are, of course, looking forward to this new age of rapid innovation and disruption in this new Kondratiev supercycle with great optimism. So are we maybe a bit too optimistic about Hyperloop and flying air taxis? Do you agree with us that they will indeed be happening in the next 10 to 20 years?
And which one would you like to try first? The flying air taxi, the Hyperloop, or the boring tunnel? And if you're new to this channel, we upload twice per week a video on topics of spaceflight, electric cars, and also other disruptive technologies just like this one. So be sure to subscribe and also click the bell.
Then see you next time. Bye.
Bye.